everyone, I'm Ranger Nicole, and welcome to the McClintock House. The McClintock family lived here from 1836 to 1856, 20 years, but never owned the house, rented it the whole time. So who were these people? Well, the McClintock family were Quakers from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, originally, before they moved up here to Waterloo, New York. And the parents are Thomas and Mary Ann McClintock. They had five children, four daughters, and one son, and they are Quakers. And Quakers believe that everyone has the same inner light and the same worth. So for a lot of them, it followed that everyone should have access to the same rights. And the McClintocks felt that way. They became involved in all sorts of different reform movements, like abolition, where they were trying to end slavery, temperance, where they were trying to prohibit alcohol usage, and many other different relief efforts. They were abolitionists first and foremost in a lot of ways, and they organized anti-slavery fairs, they circulated petitions, they ended up going to speeches given by anti-slavery speakers. They were very involved in all the communities that they lived in, and in Philadelphia, there was a big question about the role of women in abolition. Mary Ann McClintock participated in that debate. She ends up forming with a group of other women from Philadelphia, like Lucretia Mott, and they decide they're going to create their own anti-slavery society, the Philadelphia Female Anti-Slavery Society, in the 1830s. And that organization is one of the first women's political organizations in the country. It's also unique because it's a biracial organization. So black and white women working together to not only end slavery, but also to improve the communities that they all live in. So the McClintocks were involved with that as well. They were interested in education. Quakers educated all of their children equally. It didn't matter if you were a boy or a girl, you'd be educated the same regardless, which is very different from a lot of how many children were being raised at the time in the 1830s and 40s. So the Quakers, as a group, were very well educated, and the McClintocks in particular really loved education. They had an informal library that they took with them here to Waterloo as well, and they were also business owners. In Philadelphia, they had a drugstore, general store, where they sold general goods, but in their store, they decided they wouldn't sell any goods made by enslaved labor. So they wouldn't sell very popular goods like sugar or cotton, rice or tobacco. So as you can imagine, walking into a store and it's the only store around and you can't find something that you really need like sugar, it made some of their neighbors unhappy sometimes that they wouldn't carry these really popular goods. But the McClintocks didn't cave. They stuck to their values. They didn't want anything to do with supporting slavery. So they stayed away from anything that would support slavery. So they put their values before their business, and sometimes they took an economic hit because of that. And it's in the 1830s that the McClintocks are in one of those downturns in economic fortunes for them. It's also a tense time in the Quaker community. There's a big discussion about some of the tenets and structure of the Quaker faith. The McClintocks are part of the Hicksite group of Quakers who are questioning some of the more orthodox views. They are asking questions like, if we are Quakers and we believe everyone is equal and we get our directions and guidance directly from our God, then why do we need elders or hierarchy to tell us who we are, what we want, what we should be doing? Why not just listen to the spirit that comes to us? They're also asking, if we believe men and women are equal, then why are there separate meetings for men and women? Why not just have them all in the same meeting? So they're asking these really big questions, and it creates a lot of hard feelings and tensions, even within families and friends. So the climate in Philadelphia at the time is tense for the McClintocks. They're kind of looking to move away. And at the same time, they have one of Thomas's nieces living with them, a girl named Sarah. And they also have a daughter named Sarah, not confusing. But the niece, Sarah, she ends up meeting a man named Richard Hunt. And Richard Hunt, he was from Philadelphia, but he has since moved up here to Waterloo, New York. And Richard Hunt has invested in mills and real estate. He's building a name for himself here in Waterloo. He's running for town offices, helping to build everything up. So he is up here looking for a wife down in Philadelphia. Unfortunately, his first two wives, they have died young with no children. So he's looking for wife number three. He meets Sarah McClintock. They fall in love and they decide to get married and move up to Waterloo, New York. At the same time, the McClintocks are ready to move. So when their niece Sarah marries Richard Hunt and moves up here to Waterloo, the McClintock family does decide that they want to move up too. So they come up here to Waterloo, New York in 1836. They move into this house that I'm in today. The house has just been built. It's brand new in 1836. Richard Hunt owns it and he ends up renting it out to them for all of the 20 years that they live here. So they end up living here but never owning the house. Richard Hunt also lends them out a store. So they set up another general store, where they're selling similar goods, but they still won't sell any goods made by enslaved labor. So it also causes quite the stir here in Waterloo, and not everybody's happy about it, but they still continue that practice here in town. And the McClintocks, they move in. They establish themselves pretty early on as a presence in the community. They're inviting friends, townspeople, people who are traveling. Their house is always the center of activity. They are here with people of very different walks of life. There's even some accounts of, you know, people who are slaveholders sitting across the table from a staunch abolitionist. And this is one of those unusual places where those kind of people can have civil discussions and conversations and learn a little bit about each other's perspectives. So it was seen as a safe place for people to come and learn and grow, meet other people. So by the time the 1840s were happening, the McClintocks have really established themselves in the community. And it's during this time as well that the McClintocks experience a tragedy. Sarah McClintock, Richard Hunt's third wife, she has also passed away. She's had a few children, and after one of the births, she had some complications. She ends up passing away, and it's a time of grieving for the McClintocks once again. And after that, Richard Hunt does end up remarrying a couple years later. He goes back to Philadelphia to look for another wife. He ends up marrying a woman named Jane, and she becomes Jane Hunt, and they are still living here in Waterloo. And by the time 1848 rolls around, they have had a few children together, Jane and Richard. They have friends who are coming to the area, like Lucretia Mott from Philadelphia. And on July 9th, 1848, Jane will be hosting a get together at her house. So it's a natural decision to invite Miriam McClintock, who goes over. She's also inviting Lucretia Mott, who is here for a speaking tour. And Lucretia is also staying with her younger sister, Martha Coffin Wright, over in Auburn, another abolitionist. So Martha and Lucretia will be coming to this July 9th meeting. And they also invite Elizabeth Cady Stanton, who's the newcomer to town. She has just moved in 1847 and is starting to become friends with the people in Waterloo. She's becoming close with Elizabeth McClintock, who's the oldest McClintock daughter. And in 1848, Elizabeth McClintock is about 27. Elizabeth Cady Stanton is 32. So they're about the same age. They have a lot in common. They're both very well educated. They have similar opinions about how women are being treated and how changes are needed in the laws and the social, civil, and religious spheres of women's life. So getting the five women at the Hunt House on July 9th, they decide that now's the perfect time to have their own convention, to talk about women's issues, all these things that they've been talking about. And everybody is here finally. Lucretia Mott will be the headliner. The McClintocks decide that they will get very involved with this. After this meeting, Elizabeth McClintock ends up writing to a family friend, Frederick Douglass, who lives in Rochester, New York, inviting him to this convention. And Frederick Douglass, he has escaped from being enslaved by this point, traveled around for a few years, and settled in Rochester, New York. And once he ends up receiving the letter from both Elizabeth McClintock and Lucretia Mott, he decides he will be coming to the convention over in Seneca Falls in July 1848 on the 19th and 20th. So with Frederick Douglass coming, they want something worthy of him publishing what happened. So they want some sort of document, and Elizabeth Cady Stanton writes to Elizabeth McClintock that she's going to bring some thoughts over the Sunday before the convention to the McClintock house. And they end up meeting here in the McClintock parlor, where I am today. They come in here looking at the McClintock library. They're looking at American founding documents like the Declaration of Independence. They're looking at abolition founding documents that they've used to start anti-slavery societies before. And they keep going back to the Declaration of Independence. They like a lot of those big ideas, but they want to make some big changes. They end up deciding that they will change one of the famous lines of the Declaration of Independence to instead read, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men and women are created equal." That would cause quite the stir in 1848, but they want that front and center. And then what else do they talk about? They talk a lot about marriage and property rights. That's kind of their core central focus at this very first convention. They're talking about married women being able to own property after getting married. They want access to their wages, since once you got married, all your wages, they would go to your husband. They want custody of their children, since their children are considered the property of the husband. They want to be able to go to college, have higher paying professions. If you were a single woman at the time, you could be taxed, but you weren't represented in your government. So no taxation without representation, using that old American Revolutionary War call. So they put all these different things in there. And Elizabeth Cady Stanton, she really wants the right to vote for women in there. So she puts that in there. They compile this document and they end up calling it the Declaration of Sentiments. And once it's all formed, they will bring it to the convention on July 19th and 20th, 1848. And the McClintock family makes sure that everything goes smoothly there. Marianne McClintock is kind of directing people, making sure the speakers are prepared, they're ready to go. Thomas McClintock is the evening chair, one of the evenings for the evening session. And James Mott, Lucretia's husband, is the chair for the rest of the convention on that second day. So he is involved with that. And the McClintock daughters get involved as well. Elizabeth and Mary, the two oldest daughters, they will be giving speeches. They'll be handing out leaflets. And Mary McClintock, the daughter, she will be the secretary. So she'll be writing down the proceedings, who's talking, what they're saying. And those proceedings will be a part of the booklet that Frederick Douglass ends up publishing, telling us even today what happened at the convention. So what she writes down is very important. And they end up having a successful convention. They have so much to say, they decide they want to hold another convention 2 weeks later in Rochester, New York. And the McClintock family also helps to form that convention. They end up continuing to be involved in abolition and women's rights. In the early 1850s, Elizabeth McClintock, the daughter, will get married to a man named Burrow Phillips. And they are deeply in love. They're enjoying their marriage. They move to Syracuse, New York. And for a time, the family here decides that they might consider moving to Syracuse. And while they're in Syracuse, Elizabeth McClintock and Burrow Phillips are involved with the Third National Women's Rights Convention in Syracuse. They will be a part of the proceedings. And Elizabeth McClintock is a part of the business committee. Since she's very passionate about business, she's grown up working in her father's store, and she wants to pursue that one day. She tried to get an internship at a Philadelphia company, but unfortunately it was declined. One of the reasons that they gave was they said she was too old, but she gathered that it was mostly because she was a woman, and they didn't want women to be working at that site. So after that disappointment, she still continues working in her father's store. She's still interested in business, and she's still continuing with these women's rights conventions. Fortunately, shortly after the convention, they suffer a loss as a family. Burrow Phillips has a carriage accident close to Waterloo, and he does end up dying from his injuries. So Elizabeth is left a young widow. The whole family mourns, and Elizabeth McClintock goes into a period of grieving where she doesn't really do any of her activism that she's been doing her entire life thus far. So the family really reconsiders, do they want to stay in Waterloo? What is holding them here? And not so much by this point in 1856. Richard Hunt has been ill, so he is not in the picture as much anymore. Burrow Phillips has died, Sarah McClintock has died, and the family is also not doing so well economically in their store, so they're looking for a new place, and they decide they're going to move back to Pennsylvania. They take a little stop first in Easton, Pennsylvania, where they stay for a little bit, but then they move back to Philadelphia, and they're hoping that, you know, 20 years has been enough time where a lot of these tensions, they've died down, and they will be moving back to Philadelphia. They take the train back down. Coming up, they took the canal, and that was a lot longer. But since it has been 20 years, they do take the train back to Philadelphia. They reestablish themselves. Elizabeth McClintock gets her shot at owning a store. And by all accounts, she's very successful. She runs her store selling women's goods for about 30 years before she retires. So she ends up, especially when they first come back to Philadelphia, supporting the family until Thomas, the father, and Charlie, her brother, established their own stores in Philadelphia. So they will shortly have three stores in Philadelphia as a family. So they stay there for many more years. And then a lot of them end up moving to Vineland, New Jersey, which becomes a hub for women's suffrage. So they end up moving there and continuing their interest in women's rights. Elizabeth Cady Stanton ends up going there later in all of their lives, and she ends up finally remembering the McClintock family. She writes about how she remembers going to their house, writing the Declaration of Sentiments with them, and she says that she's not surprised Vineland, New Jersey became such a hub of women's suffrage because the McClintock family was there. And so the McClintocks were instrumental in especially the early women's rights movement, getting it started and continuing it on. We don't hear about them as much because they didn't write as much down as, say, Elizabeth Cady Stanton, who wrote many, many documents and autobiographies. She wrote the history of women's suffrage. So the McClintocks don't get mentioned as much because they didn't write as much down themselves. So we don't hear about them as much today, but they are just as important. And now we have their house preserved by the National Park Service. They did historical studies to find out what was here. They have preserved it, and now it'll be here for future generations to come and see the house. And if you would like to see the original Declaration of Sentiments table, that is in the Smithsonian Museum down in DC. We do have a nice reproduction table here of the same size and shape, but the original is down in the Smithsonian, so your adventure can continue exploring and seeing the table, and we hope to see you here at some point soon. So thank you for joining me here today, and have a good day. Enjoy convention days.